Hat, St. Earth, Hale, Campbell, Redford, Truman.
Realities align with the science.
Yes.
We will return again and again with this demand for the impossible until it becomes possible. Woo! We will go together in all our wonderful weirdness, all our wonderful madness, and in the spirit of the most embarrassing word in the English language, love.
Yeah.
Woo! We rebel in love for each other. We rebel in love for our wonderful living world. We rebel in love for the better people we can become. We rebel against extinction and for life.
Woo!
Extinction!
Yeah!
Extinction!
Yeah!
The bands obviously seized this morning, which is a bit unfortunate. What we're doing right now is we're going to try and like get as much food as we can going. We've got a little bit left, but we've managed to save, try and cook up like a meal.
You think it's a lot, but we've got a fair few thousand people here at the Rebellion. Like, this food will probably last a day, maybe.
This is about self-organising communities, even if you're not getting involved with climate change. This is how to come together and look after each other.
At the moment, you can see the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere is such that, seen over this time scale, it might as well be a wall. These projections of the sea levels are 2 degrees warming. We are, what, around here somewhere. When you get to 4 degrees, which is where very realistically we will be at the end of the century, then you can see that almost the whole of London will be inundated. Relative to somewhere like Bangladesh, or the Mekong Delta in Vietnam, where people are already being forced out of their homes, I mean, this is nothing. And yet this is the future that we are inviting, and that we are, because we know this, what we are wittingly letting ourselves do. It's unspeakable, and the fact that this isn't the top of the news agenda at all times is a crime.
Been all the long summer's day, sun, come tell it unto me. I've been hunting and fowling the whole day long, and its mother, pardon me, and its mama, pardon me. Oh, what put the blood on your right shoulder, son? Oh, son, come tell it unto me. Oh, that is the blood of my grey mare, or she would not rule by me, by me. For she would not rule by me. And when will I see your big blue eyes again? Son, come tell it unto me. You'll see them when the sky does turn black, and that will never, never be, never be, and that will never be.
It's 20 past six in the morning. I've been here since midnight, and we're doing police station support. So watching out for rebels that are being released post-arrest, making sure they're all right, they know where they are, they're okay, got a cup of tea. I make some vegan brownies, which seem to fill everyone with joy, even at 2 o'clock in the morning, when they are released out of a police station at 2, 3, 4 in the clock in the morning. They often don't know where they are. Sometimes they're bleary-eyed because they've been having a little bit of a nap in the cell. They're very tired and stressed. Often they don't have any ID on them. So all of these are like safeguarding risks. I've had 70-year-old women have been released onto the streets with nothing. No phone, no numbers, very little money at 3:30 in the morning. We've been doing a lot of passing people's phones, so kind of that reconnecting. We've been dealing with complex transport problems. So 4 people with no Oyster cards, then we've been trying to get them lifts, or just using our own cards to put people on buses home. This week I have to work, which is interesting. So I've been doing a 9 to 5, trying to be in bed at like 6 or 7 p.m. and then be back here for midnight to do midnight till 6. And then go into the office. I'm kind of doing one night on, one night off. I knew this would be important, but I didn't know how much it would mean to me. And I've just been taught so much by people about solidarity, about gratitude, about respect, about bravery, sheer defiance, and like our incredible collective creative brain.
Under Section 14 should be over to Trafalgar Square.
You may go to court, you may have to the record.
If I stay in here, it will be a breach of those Section 14 conditions and liable for arrest.
What's going on? Basically, Section 14.
So we have an hour to pack up and go, or we can be arrested.
And our chief officer has put a condition in place. You've got the right to protest in Trafalgar Square.
We should have the right to protest everywhere.
Talking about is our shared future. So whether we and our children will have a future or not, that's why we are here. You're talking about
I'm not against your
how you're getting paid. You're getting paid by obeying your orders. But
I'm not against your protest. I'm not against what you stand for and what you're protesting for.
Okay.
It's just maybe the way you're going about it. Should you wish to continue, what I'm saying is you need to go to Trafalgar Square to do it.
Okay, I'm just letting you know that you as a human being have a free choice not to obey your orders and let everybody rebel freely because we are rebelling for everyone, for your children as well.
It's finding the balance with everyone. It's finding the balance for you to protest and other people to go about their day.
We will only find a proper balance once we get rid of all the destructive parts of the system, right?
No.
Once we reach radical systematic change, that's when we find balance.
We have to find the real balance between you and the people protesting and every other member of society.
No, that's just an illusion of the balance, like on the surface. It's not too many disruption. That's what you're looking
for.
What we are looking for is proper balance and harmony. Real balance. That's what we are looking for. A real ecological balance, a real social balance.
We're not going to solve this now, but I'm advising you if you want to continue.
We are solving this now. We are.
You need to go
at the moment, we are solving this.
We had vegan samosas, brownies, we put on breakfast, tea, coffee, all that sort of stuff.
Do you want to get out?
Have I got a job? I'm a self-employed builder. Yeah? I work and pay my taxes. Boris?
Come on in. You give them the hot brew and a bit of food and you can see the energy lifts. Get down on it. Come on in.
Smiles like that all the time. That really is a smiley face. I'm self-employed, so lots of earnings and cost of living up here. It's probably going to cost me best part of 800 quid, you know. It's all worth it, you know. Because if we don't do something now, there won't be a future. I heard all the people saying, get down on it, come on in. Get down on it, if you
really want it. Get down on it, you gotta feel it. I'm pressing with a group called Veggies from Nottingham. Got infrastructure, all the facilities, as have several other kitchens, some of which have been seized by the police preemptively. My van's been seized, arrested on a flash for conspiracy, which is, just shows how idiotic the whole thing is, because how can they deny people the right to food and sustenance? We're very aware that the water is being carried in from some distance, so we have quite a precise system of making sure that we make best use of every drop of water. The rinsing water becomes the washing up water. The washing up water becomes the water for pre-washing to get the gunk off. So you keep your washing up water as clean and fresh for as long as possible. Every drop helps, although we're going to have storms bringing in more water than we can cope with on one hand, but droughts where there won't be any water, and the water supply itself may fail, so we may all be carrying water in jerry cans in 5 years' time. So we need to start learning these little techniques for, you know, living in an age of climate crisis.
Oh, no. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. When you're here, you really feel you want to have a role. And so for me, I've been handing out leaflets all morning. I've probably handed out a stack of about that high, probably about that many leaflets, and I'm down to this. Grab people as they're coming to work, as they're coming and going from the home office. 90% of people I hand a leaflet to are really interested. Then there's another 5% who just walk on, but you can see that they're interested. Well, a few people told me to get a real job. I have a real job. I've taken a day off. The lady came up to me and took one of my leaflets and she just burst into tears because she just wanted to do something. And so and she just gave me a big hug and then I started crying. You know, it is a strange thing because we've all got all these pent up emotions, and coming to something like this and sharing it with other people allows you to get some of it out.
I have 5 already.
I'm okay. This is a lock-on. My arm inside a tube, which is inside a bag. It's heavy, it's like concrete or something. What has brought me here is politicians in action, you know? Like, I shouldn't have to be here. This is ridiculous.
I've got Lois, who's age 9, and Jem, who's age 6, and I'm here because I'm really scared about what kind of future that they're going to have to live in.
For obstruction of a highway. Okay, so
I've never been involved in something like this before, and it's helping me deal with my own anxiety and grief, I think, about the future.
I don't want to be arrested, but I'm doing it for the right reasons.
Okay. It shouldn't be the case that people are out here on the streets defending the lives of their own children.
Our children!
I need to speak to the rest of support about my dad.
About who?
My dad.
Has
he been arrested?
Who's
Blenheim?
Who's Blenheim?
Who's Justice?
Our Justice!
Who's London?
Our London!
Who's Streets?
Our Streets!
Who's Blenheim?
Our Blenheim!
We're part of Animal Rebellion, which is a separate group to Extinction Rebellion, but we've come together in solidarity. And our message is that there is a climate emergency, we do have to do something about it, and a plant-based diet and going vegan is one of the best things that we can do as individuals. It's going to be, they're estimating 1 billion climate refugees, and you know, we have family here in London, and if something goes wrong, we get soaked or we lose all our stuff, we can just go and stay with them or go back home. When you're a climate refugee, you're not going to have that. This is going to be everything. And already there's so many people around the world where this is all they have. The people with the same professions and the same opportunities as us who then have lost it all and are now just staying in a tent.
We are in Marsham Street. We are opposite to the Home Office, and this is a church. It's called Emmanuel Evangelical Church. Since Monday, some people asked for it, and we try to arrange a way that they could use our toilets. And they've been amazing people. For us, was a surprise, but as our pastor told us, it's a human thing to do. It's a kind thing to do, and as Christians, you cannot be inhuman and being a Christian. You are very kind people and very grateful people as well, because sometimes we do things for people and they don't even notice it. 2 weeks ago we had a book launch, a speaker from America talking about how we are getting to the point of no return, and it was very impactful. Yes. So we are aware, as a church as well, that's something that we learn. We are stewards of the planet and we have to take care of it.
We are outside an oil conference right now. We know that in order to have any chance of getting our carbon emissions low enough to make future survival of our children possible, we need to leave those fossil fuels in the ground. And in that building, there are people right now trying to figure out how to get more and more and more of it out of the ground. And we are utterly opposed to it, and that's why we're here protesting, both here and at our Liverpool Street station. For many years, the fossil fuel companies have known the damage that they're doing to public health, and yet they've continued to extract fossil fuels and they've continued to spread lies and deceit about the damage it is causing. We know that they were paying, lobbying all sorts of high profile people to blow smoke around the science. And it is horrendous what they're doing. It's criminal what they're doing. It's negligent what they're doing. And we're here to say we need to stop it. And we need to stop it now.
So just be mindful, you are under caution, all right? So anything you do say can be used in evidence. I'll just remind you of your legal right, okay?
That's very good, I cheers. So yeah, we're just here. Blocking, there's a big wig conference going on for oil and gas. $4,500 for a ticket to get in there. We're locked on, so we can't move. We've blocked a highway to cause maximum disruption so that we can get heard. This morning we were at the BBC, so the BBC would stop being silent and try and report this, but they're still not. So we have to keep on going and going and going and going until somebody finally listens.
That's the first sip of iron brew I've had for 40 years. I think somebody brought it along as a prop and I've been drinking it. There's four of us here, three from the Highlands and one from just ordinary Scotland, and we're all locked on to this barrel. I'm not really doing it for anyone, I'm doing it because it's the right thing to do. It's not just our species that's going to suffer. We're already seeing extinctions of other species, so we've really got to change our ways, and change our ways very, very soon.
So any one time we probably got anywhere between a dozen and two dozen riders. Some will just be on bikes with panniers. We've got riders with much, much larger cargo bikes, which can take people and tents and drums and marquees. And then we've got people on trailers as well who will do a lot of the food stuff. This morning I've been picking up rubbish bags and getting them all onto one site, making sure that everyone's got blankets and you know, extra food. You know, there'll be a bag of rice to pick up from our food store and get it to a particular site, hot food to get to another place, empties to take back to the main kitchen. It's a really amazing team of riders that we have out there. They're literally riding missions for the rebellion, you know, and they've got to do it in a really careful manner. They've got to get to a particular point at a particular time, and sometimes do it a bit discreetly as well. A lot of people probably think that rebelling is about coming down and waving a placard and shouting some slogans and sitting in the road, and absolutely that's a really important part of it. But there are so many different jobs that need to be done, and so many really interesting roles that you can do if you want to support it. It's been a really, really wonderful, empowering experience.
We are an autonomous site, so we consult, we feedback, we have decision-making processes that allow a huge amount of feedback, and then we as a site decide what we would like to do.
Representing Animal Rebellion, we are so happy and honoured to be standing alongside Extinction Rebellion,
yes,
as part of the Movement of Movements and Rebel Alliance. We also have a lot of actions planned. We haven't had the grounding to be able to think about really how we're going
week.
To do that.
But we can do more, we can do better. We're not weak on infrastructure, we're not worried about that. We've got a lot of support.
Mixed feelings on this as to what we should do and what the correct direction is, and mixed feelings in particular on whether to even hold the site. General feeling to just keep that motto
afloat like water.
So basically,
the questions are, do we stay or do we go? Get into groups of 8 to 10 people so that everybody gets heard equally.
Our group voted to stay. The Animal Rebellion are here and they want DEFRA to hear their demands. The traffic disruption here is perhaps not obvious to
us. Our consensus is to move because we think it's not safe to unload our infrastructure here, and we need fresh energy
and have some toilets and that kind of thing to make it also comfortable to stay on as long as they can.
We don't want to go to Trafalgar Square, and we trust whichever decision is taken about where to go.
And we'd like to be part of a large procession. We trust the coordinators to know where that site might be.
Love you all. We're happy to stay if that's the consensus, because we have the numbers, but we feel that
we would like to go, and whilst doing so, cause as much disruption as possible.
Dignity, heads held high and in full song, and we don't want to go to Trafalgar Square.
We're just going to get a little bit of feedback from all you guys as to how much you agree with those broad suggestions. So, first option, stay. This is a strong site. I'm giving that 10. There was a move towards leaving. We need to have some people to go to the other sites to build links, to share info. We need to sing.
Audit arrestables.
We should leave as soon as possible and regroup. No, nobody's even waving their hands on that one. Zero. Maximum disruption. Change our plans.
At the drop of a hat, flow like water.
We need to do yoga. Yeah. We don't want to go to Trafalgar Square.
Heaven.
That the movement should be a regenerative and disruptive action in itself. That's a 12. Pass that up to the action coordinators and there'll be some feedback soon. Give yourself a big shout, guys. Brilliant. Democracy in action.
How many people have been through those doors using the toilets and the facilities? And so I think as a massive group, if you could just raise your voices in thanks to this church for being so hospitable.
Thank you.
on now. This weight that I'm under, my body is numb now.
Thank you.
started off in St James's Park, had the first 2 days just putting up structures, getting things absolutely organised and making sure people were doing the right thing. We got moved on Thursday, so that was a heck of a job. Forward, backward, and trying to avoid the nice constabulary. And then another 2 days setting up here. So you've got all the marquees, gazebos, communal tents we've got set up over there, so loads of people who have their tents confiscated or broken or things like that. You need the kitchens up first. The kitchens have been amazing.
My role here is to look after all of the food coming in and out and make sure everyone gets a full belly, and look after the teams that are working in our kitchens, getting equipment in and out, sourcing the food, donations, arranging couriers, sorting out the gas, talking to the fire brigade, talking to the water people, the bin people. That's pretty much it. We've still got a lot of stuff impounded, like more than half of our kitchen stuff that belongs to XR is in police property at the moment. So now we've got 3 tea and coffee and snacks tents, and then we've got this big kitchen just serving 3 hot meals a day with massive help from a couple of kitchens outside site as well. Obviously, this kind of thing doesn't happen without everyone chipping in. So I've got good mates that are very competent chefs, and they're helping me out a lot. I've grabbed onto every single person I know, almost in the world. Excluding snacks, we probably serve about 850 litre containers per meal, and they feed probably about 200 people, 300 people. And then there's like bread and bananas and snacks and tea and so many biscuits.
I'm actually managing all of the waste and sanitation for the rebellion. The bins, organising all of the recycling and toilets, and just making sure it all comes together. It's been so hard to get any toilets on any of the sites. We bought 12 compostable toilets to this site yesterday. We spent a bit of money on it, but it's like so people can poo and pee in peace. And we've got like a little rota system going on where people are changing the compost. And we've also got a guy in Kent who's willing to take all of the waste. It's like black gold, so he can use it for his fertilizer in a year's time. This is like showing that we can actually have a community that works together and thrives. Banding together is how we make it work.
We've got loads of curry and loads of bread.
And loads of bread.
And there's going to be Christmas in an unknown amount of time, but probably not
this long. There was 3 of us in the tent last night. 3 in a row. You need the body heat to keep warm when you're out here in October and it's rainy.
I think in terms of people's energy and morale, you want to come back to your community and rest for the day ahead. People are just incredibly generous. I think the biggest thing you notice is the humanity that keeps the rebellion going.
I'm an integrator, and mostly my role is to connect coordinators with crew so that we've got enough things like stewards and leafleters and first aid and all the rest of it. I've also been integrating at site level as well, so just connecting dots from one person to another, and it's full-time work. It's amazing seeing the self-organising system unfold.
I'm in my element and I love doing this, and this is one of the most inspiring, beautiful things that I think I can do, and it feels like I'm in the right place.
Just a gopher. I don't care what I do as long as I'm doing. And I mean, I did come down with a full attempt to really cause chaos, but actually what we're doing gives the opportunity for everybody else to do that.
I haven't really had any time to like go and like experience the rebellion, but I'm experiencing it in my own way, which is like amazing and beautiful. And like, knowing that I'm actually doing something for this is incredible.
Don't just take sticks. At a certain point, it becomes full.
Where's the sanitation?
I feel like sometimes, especially within XR, like I'm being used more as like a way to show the movement's more diverse rather than actually being given a platform because they want to give me a platform. earliest day, I was standing by a banner. Behind me, there was a politician, a white male, who was being interviewed, and a woman from XR UK. She was like, get in shot, we need to show that there's not just white people in XR, like, try and jump in the shot. And so she wasn't thinking about my voice, she just wanted, like, to make it seem like we're more diverse than we are. And then immediately after, she shoved a camera in my face with her, and she started talking to the camera and was like, as you can see behind me, there's a white man being interviewed, but this person here should be interviewed instead. And then as soon as I started to speak, they turned off the camera. There are a lot of problematic things that have gone on, and then sometimes I feel that when we try and voice as people who are actually being affected by this, as people who can give like an actual perspective, we're being told not to speak, or that we're being aggressive, or that we need to like not dilute the message. It means that there's a lot of emotional labour that has to be done by the people of colour in a movement, which means it makes people not want to be in the movement. If you're not in certain groups, you wouldn't realise this is happening in XR or in any movement. I am happy to be here, I'm happy to be locked on. I'm also still wanting to address the issues that are within the movement. You've got to take the shit, sorry.
This is the Department of Work and Pensions, and I think we're congregating against the current law. As far as I'm concerned, there is still a Section 14 on the entire City of London, so I think we are all a little bit arrestable right now. I don't know for sure, though, because police don't seem to be doing that at the moment anyway. I have been stood here and in other places the past couple of weeks, and I've had people asking me questions, which is brilliant. Number one was, how should we talk to a climate change denier or a skeptic? What should we say to them? That's the shortest one to answer, because my opinion is don't. We are interested in converting the low-hanging fruit. We're interested in talking to the people who are almost with us, just need a little nudge. And these people are on the other end of the normal curve. We'll talk to them when we've spoken to everybody else. We don't need to invest emotional energy and time into trying to turn them around. It won't work. I just did a little estimation the other day, and I reckon there's been 120,000 man years of research gone into climate change. I think we know enough. It's time to do something, and I fully respect the climate scientists who carry on doing the research, monitoring what's going on and providing us with further information, refining and improving the models. That's great, but we don't need more climate science. We need more climate action, and that's why I'm here.
Climate justice now. People gonna rise like water. Turn this system round.
So I'm a scientist at the University of Cambridge. I'm working on physical sciences and engineering. I've never been politicised, and this is the first time I feel it's really important. Almost the entire science academic population in all the universities in the country are behind this. And I think one of my jobs is, I think, now to try and encourage everybody to stand up, because the science is just completely factual. There's no doubt in any way about what's going on. When I do experiments, it fails 100 times and it might work the 101st time. We're doing an experiment on this planet. It's a completely uncoordinated experiment. We only have one planet. It's a completely disastrous way to proceed. I'm more and more worried that the IPCC reports are much too gentle and optimistic. And the more data, the real data that I see, makes me more and more worried about what's going on. So we have to change, we have to do something.
It's very nice, but I'm not real interested in it.
Why not?
I don't give so shit. Much. I don't give shit about climate.
And do you think the environment movement isn't that relevant to you? Or?
No.
Why not?
Because I can't do anything to it.
Okay. Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, have a lovely time. Yeah.
I'm a former army officer. I did 5 years with the Royal Tank Regiment. I then did 13 years with Devon and Cornwall Police in various roles, including at the end in emergency planning. I'm the kind of conduit for communications between the police and the rebels so that tensions don't escalate. It's helpful to understand, you know, what the police would like us to do. I can pass that on to rebels. They can then decide whether they actually want to do that or not. It helps things to run smoothly during an action. Sometimes, you know, I'll be able to say to the bronze commander, the police bronze, look, you know, these guys are all autonomous, you know, it's a bit like herding cats, but look, they want to hold a people's assembly to decide what to do. So if you could just give us a few moments to do that, that would be really helpful. And so again, I think that allows us to, you know, put our democratic processes in place as well. One of the things that's concerned me about the way the policing has gone this time around is that there's been really no recognition that this peaceful protest has involved older people, disabled people, and children. I'm a little bit alarmed at the way the police have deliberately tried to make it uncomfortable for us to carry out our peaceful protest. I don't believe that's their remit. They should be facilitating it on the one hand, as well as policing any offences that are committed. So I think their response has been a little bit heavy-handed, if I'm honest. Working with children, it breaks my heart to know the future that is potentially in store for them. It's a very dystopian future. I cannot imagine how they will feel when they realise that my generation has bequeathed them the world that they will live in, which will not be pleasant. Food shortages, mass migration, you know, these are not circumstances which are conducive to a benign society. There will be deaths, there will be riots, there will be unpleasantness. I can't stand by and do nothing knowing what I know now. So that's why I'm here.
Having a spray paint spray with chalk. I spray painted other people's hands. It's ridiculous, you know? It's ridiculous.
I'm basically usually extremely law-abiding and I don't really like disputes. I don't like to be confrontational, apart from when it's entirely necessary. And this is one of those times.
Feeling desperate. So desperate times take desperate measures, but we're trying to be disruptive in the most peaceful, creative way we possibly can.
We welcome everyone and all parts of everyone.
It was quite strange walking along here. A year, 2 years ago, I would have been walking down this street looking at these beautiful things and wishing I could afford them. And I have no desire for any of these things anymore because I know that, you know, there are no handbags on a dead planet.
I'm disappointed that the government is still not telling the truth, that the mainstream media have more or less blacked out the protests and they certainly don't cover the climate crisis adequately. I think people walking past us in the street in Oxford Street don't realise that their kids' lives are in danger. They're not being told. since April, nothing really substantial has been done apart from uttering a few fine words. We will keep coming back until they take the action that we need.
I've got an angle grinding work, I can get that.
I don't really think that's going to solve it, is it? Do you know what I mean? They've got human rights too, they've got the right to protest, mate. No, they're doing it.
To protest in London has been made illegal.
That's why they're being arrested.
Look, they're still up. Get rid of it.
Done, innit?